Hey guys, how's it going today? Today what I got is something I haven't done in a while. This is a machine review, and we got this guy right here. So what this is a lathe I actually got in a roundabout way. I actually got it. It ended up being, cost me nothing. I traded a machine that I had, and I actually got a Bridgeport and this thing for it. Because I wheel and deal with machines, so I've got nothing into this guy right now, but it's still worth quite a bit of money. There are a lot of videos on YouTube about a lot of guys with these things. They want to sell them, so they run through their paces and say, you know, here's a machine, you want to buy it? Well, I'm not going to do that today. I'm just kind of going to go over some of the basic features of this lathe and some of the cool things about it. We'll maybe take a little cut on it and check it out. So let's check it out. Alright, so what this thing is a 1960, I checked the serial number, but it's either a 68 or a 69 South Bend 13 by 40, which is the 6 foot bed. They came in, I believe, 5, 6, 7 and maybe 8. Don't quote me on the 8, but they came in a few bed lengths. Might even have been some shorter than that, but this 13 by 40 is a pretty popular lathe for a lot of guys that want to do gunsmithing, and even for, you know, whatever they want to do in their home shop. This is quite a bit of a step up from the heavy 10, which I have down in my basement. I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do with this machine yet. I was contemplating keeping both this one and my heavy 10, or selling my heavy 10 and restoring this one. I'm not quite sure yet what I'm going to do yet. I hate to sell this one because it's in such nice shape. It's got the hardened bedways, and it's got the large 240 or 250 increment micrometers. It's got a taper attachment. I've got the telescoping steady. You can see it back here. The telescoping steady and follower for it. I got a collet attachment for it, drawbar and some other original South Bend 3-jaw, original South Bend 4-jaw. And it is a three-phase machine, so what I ended up doing is I got a Tico, I believe it's an FM or a TM50. It's kind of the common one that most guys use. Wired it up for 220 volt single phase. And I also put a potentiometer on here, and I got an original South Bend, well, I don't know if it's South Bend, but it's one of the ones that South Bend use. I think it's a Cutler switch, this one is. And I put a potentiometer on there to vary the speed on it. The switch on my particular lathe is kind of beat up. The contacts have been fried a little bit, so it's not the best contact. I actually got to replace that switch. The original switch that was on here was the push button, start, forward, reverse, and stop. But my VFD that I'm using isn't compatible with that one without a bunch of extra wiring, so I didn't want to do that, so I just went this way. And it works good. Alright, let's crank it up. See if my switch works today. Here we go. Give it a little kickstart. So as you can see, it's pretty quiet, and I do have an old belt that I pulled off actually another lathe. I think I pulled this off a heavy 10, and it was actually longer on the heavy 10 than for the 13 inch lathe here. And I re-spliced it, and be that it's an old brittle belt, I don't really have it tightened down very, I don't have a lot of tension on it, so it slips a little bit. But here, so it's running, I believe we're at 418 RPMs. I can go grab my tack. Maybe I'll do that in a second here, and we can actually see what this thing's running at. But we can crank the VFD down to about half speed. Crank it down to about quarter speed. And at a higher speed, the higher gearing like this, you probably wouldn't run it like this too often. We can crank it back up. And you can see I got my my switch here wired in forward and reverse. So let me flop it in back gear here and I'll start it over again. So one thing that's kind of different about these heavy 10s and probably the 14 and a half, 16s and larger lathes, to pull a bolt pin, you actually just push it down out of the way and that releases your cone. And then we can put the back gear in. So just plop that in and then we can start turning. All right, so back gear, we should be running about 209 RPMs. You can tell if the back gears, you know, with any lathe, they usually get a little noisier. Just to see how nice and quiet my outboard gears are. My bad switch. Not much louder than, actually the back gear is the noisiest thing on here. And again, we can crank the VFD way down. And if we actually wanted to go to a crawl, that's the cool thing about these VFDs. They're not the answer to everything, but they're a pretty cool option. So now we're going actually, so that's the fastest speed on back gears. Let's slow this baby down to a real crawl. And the thing I like about these 13s is that with these cast iron bases, and you can get them on the heavy 10s too, but you don't have to open the door or close the door before you crank the tension handle. That cabinet I have on my heavy 10, you have to crank the handle and open the door and then shut the door and then crank the handle back, which is kind of a pain. But so here we're going, so this is the slowest setting in back gear, and there's only one step on the pulley from the motor to the jack shaft. So this is full speed in low gear, it's about 135 RPMs. Then we can crank her down to like a crawl. So I'm assuming we're going maybe 10 or 15 RPMs. And you can see we got quite a bit of torque there. Putting quite a bit of pressure on there. So that's nice if you want to like thread something. I don't know if you'd ever want to thread something that slow, but it's nice to be able to crank down that slow if you need it. Alright, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to test the RPMs on this thing. I'll just test one probably. At some point in time, somebody wrote the RPMs on this guy. A lot of guys do that. So our high speed, if you can see that, it's 948 RPMs. And that should be, even with our VFD, that should be what we're getting. See how close we are. So that's 702. Let's crank it up. Full speed. So $878, give or take a little. And we're at full speed there, so not quite as fast as you think it should go, but I guess fast enough. These bigger lathes, they all didn't, some of them only had 3-step pulleys, and I don't know, the 13 inches, I don't know if many of them had dual step on the motor pulleys. I think a single, this one actually has 2 belts on a single step, or a dual belt setup. So it only goes 1 speed, and then the high range in the back gear. So at these bigger lathes, you're not running the faster RPMs like you do on the smaller south bends. I think my heavy 10 runs at 14 or 1450 RPMs. So you're losing some RPMs when you're going up to a bigger lathe like this, but you're usually turning bigger pieces anyway, so your cut rate is gonna be similar. Alright, so I got just a piece of cold rolled bar, I don't know, it could be hot rolled, I don't know what it is. It's a piece of steel I had laying around, I don't even know what it is. So I'm gonna crank it up, I'm gonna do, what's my feed rate? 8.5 thousandths per revolution, and I'm going the fastest speed, and then I'm just gonna feed in. So we'll take a cut, maybe do a 10 thousandths and maybe a 20,000th cut and see how well it does here with my, I gotta remember I got a slippy belt here too. Another thing I didn't mention is I got a Loris tool post holder on here too, so that's kind of nice. See, it slips, it turns on and it slips, so we'll see if it'll, work here. So I can hear my belt slipping. So I'm going to try and tighten my belt up and see if we can get a little better cut going here. Alright, got it tightened up a little bit and it works a little better. I'm going to use a little, I don't have anything better than WD-40 at the moment, so out in my garage here, but I'm going to crank in, oh, 15,000ths, because last time we did 10, oh what the hell, let's do 20, let's do a full 20,000ths cut, and we'll see how well it cuts. Smoothest finish, but okay. I could go a little finer cut, but so it's 20. So let's do 30,000ths. Let's see how it does with 30. Probably bog it down a little bit. Still getting a rough finish, but we're doing, it's okay. If we do 30, let's do 40. What the hell, let's do a 50,000th cut and see what happens. Gotta start. My dial is off a little, so let's reset it here. 50,000ths. That was a hell of a cut. Bogged her down a little bit, but it took it. 50,000ths. That's awesome. There we go, enough dinking around with that. Alright, so there we go. So that's kind of a quick overview of these heavy 13s, 13 inch south bends. They're kind of fun. You can see we just took a pretty heavy cut there. So there's a lot of guys out there thinking, well, I got crap on my floor, I need to move it. No, there's a lot of guys out there thinking, you know, maybe I want a 13 inch. You know, they might not necessarily need it, but maybe they want it. So owning a couple of these different lathes, I can tell you the big difference between these two is there's two main things. Of course, number one, other than size, which we'll get to it here in a second, but this thing weighs probably about, I think they're about 500 or 600 pounds heavier than the Heavy 10. That's good as far as If you want, you know, your rigidity and your stability when you're machining stuff, you got a nice solid hunk of steel to machine with. The bad side about that is if a lot of guys like me, if we want to put it down in our basement, it's a son of a bee to get down in your basement. You can take all these pieces and parts apart, and they're pretty manageable all by themselves. The only one that's really a tough one to get is the bed. And I'm not sure, there's some guys out there like Brad Jacobs and a few of those guys, they could probably tell you how much these things weigh. I'm not sure yet. I don't know if I want to find out. I might find out, we'll see. I'm guessing this bed probably weighs 300 to 400 pounds by itself. Probably more like 4. So you're gonna need a couple of good buddies or some really good moving equipment to get this guy down in your basement, unless you got a walkout basement, then you're set. So that's one of the main things, is the weight. And of course, secondly, is between the 13 and the 14, the longest bed on a heavy 10 that you can get is 4.5 feet long, which gives you about a 36 inch between center cutting distance. This one with the 6 foot bed gives you a 40 inch between centers. And then you also get another approximately 3 inches of swing over your bed. I don't know what the actual swing over the cross slide is, but I'm sure you get another, you get a little bit more with the 13. The only other, like for guys like me that do a lot of gunsmithing, this is a really nice lathe to do gunsmithing work on. The only downside on it that I can see is if you're using a chuck, I don't have my tape measure handy here, but I measured it the other day. I think it's 21, somewhere between 21 or 23 inches from the face of your chuck to the outside of your spindle. My heavy 10 is, I think it's 16 or 17, 18, something like that. So you're losing probably 4 inches or so in length through your headstock. So if you're doing shorter barrels, like 16 inch carbine barrels or 18 or 20 inch even, you're gonna have a tough time doing those through the headstock. You absolutely could still use a steady rest out here, and guys make spiders for the steady rest so they can still dial them in. The only problem, you know, if you've done it on a steady rest, is it's hard to dial in this end of it unless you cut a center and you're running off a center on this end. So that would be the way, in my opinion, to do it. So that's the one downside to this 13 inch for gunsmithing, is the length between the headstock. But other than that, I mean, hell, it's a nice machine. If you want to do, you know, this isn't going to be a production machine. A lot of guys that do gunsmithing today need machines that'll cut metric threads. And you can get these things to cut metric threads. However, if you can find a metric set for them, that's the first obstacle. Second obstacle is, do you want to pay for them? Or if you get lucky and just find them with it. I actually found a set of metric teeth for my heavy 10, brand new, never used like most of them I've seen, and it's still sitting in the box. I haven't touched it yet. So, but I have the ability. The only thing is, they usually took special threading dials with those metric threads. There's ways around it, but long story. So anyways, there we go. I got a little long-winded, but hopefully that gave a few of you a little bit of insight maybe on one of these. If you're looking between a 13 and a 10, a lot of times it comes down to what you can find in your area and what's available and what you can afford. If you can afford a bigger machine like this and you're doing a lot of longer barrels, I'd say yeah, go for it. Because everything else being equal, other than the weight and the size, they're going to do the same thing. One thing I forgot to mention, if you do the spindle bore on these things is the exact same inch and 3/8 as the heavy 10s. Not the 10Rs. The 10Rs have they're like an inch spindle bore, or a 7/8 or whatever it is. It's some goofy thing, but so this threaded spindle on this guy It's a 2 1/4 by 8, so you can I can swap these chucks over with my heavy 10. So if I did decide to keep both of them, I could use both chucks as long as the runout's okay. Both chucks on each machine. I don't know. That's about it. I mean, these things are neat old machines, and I just happened to come across this one. Right timing, right deal, right everything. It worked out for me, so now I own it. I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but anyways, here we go. Oh, if you stuck through me for all that my rambling, I appreciate it. If you like this video, please be sure to give me a thumbs up, and be sure to comment below. I read them all, and I reply to them all. I got some more lathe videos like this I'm going to be posting here in the near future, and hopefully in the next few days I'll get to be able to go out and shoot that Mauser that I've been working on. So the precision Mauser, I got some rounds loaded up for it after we crowned it, and we're going to go out and shoot it and see how it shoots, if it shoots any better. And after that, we're going to go to the next step. So, quick preview after everything I just said. I got a Delta lathe over here that I got for next to nothing because it was broken, so I had to repair it. And I got a couple other smaller south bends here that I'm going to go over just briefly. I might make a short video on them, I'm not sure yet, but so there we go. So, like I said before, like, comment, share, and subscribe if you haven't already. Please be sure to refer the video and tell your friends, tell your families, tell your neighbors, anybody you want to tell, let them know. So till next time, stay safe on your machines and shoot safe. I'll see you guys next time. Thanks for watching.